Good morning and welcome to our joint service of Peace Lutheran Church and the Methodist Churches of Pendleton and Hermiston. It's always a joy to have you with us this morning. I pray that you are doing well. Those folks that are having a little trouble breathing in the smoke, God bless you and be with you. Our prayers, of course, are with all those people suffering in the midst of this for, well, the many effects it has on our lives. Sadly, there was smoke here in the sanctuary when we started this morning. It's starting to clear, thankfully, but it is everywhere. I do have some announcements as I'd like to begin with on this fine morning, well, this smoky morning. First off, tomorrow night we'll be having a council meeting here at Peace Lutheran Church at 6 p.m. If you are on council, please join us. Also, the Methodists are having their Bible study at 7 p.m. on Tuesday. Patty will be sending you out the information on that, so keep a weather eye out for that. I'd also like to say a very large thank you to all those people that have already donated to our sanctuary fund. We've got $5,000 towards our goal, which is a big first step, and we're really grateful. We've already started with a new sound system, but we need to replace the carpet, get some fresh paint in here, and just freshen up the sanctuary. If you can continue to give to that, we are grateful, but we do want to remind people to please don't do that to the detriment of our general fund. Our offering is down a little bit these last few months, which is not uncommon for this time of year, but if you are able, give a little bit so we can continue to do our general work here at the church. We appreciate that very much. Let's see. Oh, the one last announcement I have is that we are sending off the school kits that go to the kids all over the country and all over the world to help them with the start of the school year. So the information about that, the specifics of what we need to have donated, are on the Peace Lutheran website. That's peaceinpendleton.org. So check that out, and if you are able, drop off some supplies. I know that the school year is looking strange right now, so maybe you have some extra supplies for floating around. If so, check out the kits and see if you can offer them to others. That would be much appreciated. Now, before we, I should say, with the beginning of our service in earnest here, I'd like to start with a moment of silence for all those people that are suffering from the fires. I myself personally know a few people that have been evacuated and a few people that have lost homes. So it is affecting everyone in our region, not just our state, but California, Washington, and the smoke is hitting some people very hard. So let's just start with a moment of silence for them, and I'll end that with a prayer. Lord God, we ask for your blessing and your comfort to those people that are suffering due to these fires that are ravaging the whole West. We ask for your strength, your comfort, and your encouragement that we might reach out to those people we can help, to offer aid, comfort, and peace in the midst of the trauma, the pain of loss and displacement. Excuse me. You yourself were a refugee as a child, Lord Christ. And these people are forced to be refugees because of the loss of their homes. We know you care for the one who wanders and who is lost. And there are many people wandering and lost right now. Offer them peace and hope and a place to land, a home. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen. Excuse me. Now we come to our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. We come now to our opening dialogue. Thank you, Karen.
Jesus Christ, light of life, shine in your people here.
Stay with us now, put fear to flight, as morning ushers in the light.
Warm the daybreak with your love and light.
And if you would join us in the prayer of the day, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, merciful Judge,
you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness.
Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And as we begin our readings today, We're moving into the Old Testament, the very beginnings of the Old Testament. So today's reading is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 4b through 7, 15 through 17, and chapter 3, 1 through 8. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Here ends the reading. Now we will go into Psalm 141.
Thank you.
Together, let us sing our gospel canticle.
Our gospel reading this morning is once again from the book of Luke, chapter 11, verses 2 through 4. The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
He said to them, "When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those everyone indebted to us, and do not bring us to the time of trial." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated, everyone. So this morning, Patty and I are going to do our sermon together, which is a little bit different. We've done it before, but we wanted to conclude our discussion on the Lord's Prayer this way because we've both been preaching on it back and forth. It's been a lot of fun, actually, for me to preach on the Lord's Prayer. There's a lot of depth to it, even though, in many ways, the message is very simple. We've talked about each of the different categories at one time or another, and today we're focusing primarily on forgiveness. We thought that would be an appropriate message to combine our efforts and to end our series on, was the idea of forgiveness. Because that word, that forgiveness, forgive us as we forgive others, or forgive our trespasses as we forgive the trespasses of others, or debts or sins, we speak about it in different ways, but it speaks to our daily life. And, well, it's we'll get to that, I suppose. I don't want to jump ahead. So, of course, the the first question we wanted to talk about a little bit is, what is sin? What is the thing that we need forgiveness for, or from, or, well, for, I suppose, is the best way to say it. So sin is described in many different ways. Oftentimes in my confirmation classes, we talk about it as the thing that separates us from God and from one another. It's an act oftentimes. There's big S sins, which is sort of a state of sin, and there's little s sins, which are specific things that hurt our relationship with one another and particularly with God. Did you have anything you wanted to?
Well, I do. One of the things that we are all accustomed, no matter what our denomination is we're accustomed to saying the confession or this prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. And the words that we use, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Mm-hmm. And you know, we're pretty good at saying that. It's by rote. Mm-hmm. We've memorized it.
We say it too, sure.
Yes, absolutely. And so I think that when we do say those words, and if we would say them more often and really think about what they mean, that would sort of put it into a perspective that then we would be able to examine our own lives.
Right. I think we all have a general sense that we know that sin is something that we do. We know sin is out in the world. I mean, it's impossible to ignore and to miss, right? But we do have to ask, how do we always recognize sin? Because sometimes, I don't want to say that it's subjective, but sometimes one person will think something is perfectly fine and another person will think that it is a sin or sinful or hurtful, however you want to describe that. So in thinking about sin, we have to think about how we recognize it. And tradition and my own experience tells me mostly our conscience makes that pretty clear, right? When we do something wrong, we feel bad about it. We recognize that right away. We're at the very least quite uncomfortable when we've done something we feel like we probably shouldn't have done. Now, of course, it's not true that all people feel that way, but I think we overblow that. There aren't really that many sociopaths in the world, thanks be to God. Most of us, we just get inert, immune to the idea of hurting others. Sometimes if we're acting badly, if we're sinning all the time, we just sort of ignore that little voice in the back of our head saying, you got to knock it off. But most people that I encounter, even hardened criminals, people who have made a career of sin, they know that they shouldn't be doing it. I mean, do you have anything you want to add?
Yes, absolutely. I agree with that. And if our conscience isn't working, just be still for a minute, because someone will point out to you that you are sinning, and sometimes not in the kindest, most loving way that Jesus would have us be to one another.
Right.
I've had that happen in my own life, as I'm sure most of you have too. So, yeah, that is a space that we could maybe take a deep breath and reflect on what's happening there.
Mm-hmm. And I would say, if you are unsure, speak to other Christians in your lives. Talk to them. Talk to your pastors and say, you know, I feel like I don't know what's going on. I feel bad about this, or I feel uncomfortable, and I need some clarity. Give us a call. Come visit us. We'd love to think that through and pray that through with you. And to that end, we wanted to talk a little bit about how do we seek forgiveness. I'll let Dorothy talk about this a little bit if she wants, or is it my turn? I forgot. We talked about this a little bit beforehand. But forgiveness is deeply important, that we seek it for one another, for our relationships, and of course with God, to seek that forgiveness.
Right? That's true. We, you know, that the best thing we can do is own it. Mm-hmm. Identify it, own it, hold it up to the light, shine that light through it, and then just, you know, ask for forgiveness. You know, Peter said to Jesus, I'm supposed to forgive these people 7 times 7. And what did Jesus say? No, 70 times 7. Just think about how we can forgive others. Mm-hmm. How could we do that? I mean, we're in the world of technology. If you have a cell phone, a tablet, a desktop computer, our devices are endless. Mm. There's no one that we cannot get in touch with to talk it out if there's been kind of a rift And you need to ask for forgiveness. Absolutely. Just own it and go for it. You know, that air is so much purer. That load is so much lighter when you do that.
Well, that's something we talked about. It's amazing how little accidental, well, not always accidental, but little hurts that we do to one another, they grow over time, right? So if we don't seek that forgiveness right away, the pain and the, I guess, the embarrassment and the struggle, the hesitance just grows as time goes on. So the nice thing about being able to connect with one another so quickly in so many ways, as you say, is that we can seek that forgiveness immediately. We know, right. I always know anyway, that I've done something wrong and I need to apologize. You know, I forgot something, I missed an appointment, I said something stupid and that I didn't intend to say or that was taken the wrong way. And it's all, if I just say, hey, I'm sorry, that's not what I meant right away, it usually evaporates. But if I am too embarrassed and I let it simmer, it gets so much harder, right?
It builds that load. It adds to that weight on our shoulders. So I want to share just a little fast story
of
with
course.
You. But many years ago, I think it was in 2005, there was a school shooting, and it never makes the list of school shootings for some reason, and I'm not sure why. But it was at the Nickel Mines School in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. And a man walked into an Amish school, mm-hmm. and he shot 11 people, six children who died. Six. So when all of the books were written and when the media was all over it, covering it, the one thing that they just didn't seem to be able to let go of was this idea that in that community, the first thing that they did was forgive the shooter. And a woman said at the time, she was a mom of a little girl who was killed. She says that forgiveness means giving up my right to revenge. Now, obviously, if someone slights you a little bit, you know, revenge isn't even a word but for big sins, I mean, think about the courage and the faith that it took to say that. Mm-hmm. But that kind of forgiveness, it doesn't really say that it was okay that it happened.
Right.
It should ever be forgotten. It shouldn't be. But it takes away, in this case, the person who committed the crime had committed suicide. But it took away the ability to hurt that young man's family or his community. And I just thought that was one of the most profound acts of forgiveness that I had ever seen in my life. And yet, it's how they lived day in and day out in these Amish communities.
It brings to my mind, too, the fact that forgiveness is an act of faith, a faith in God, faith that God can restore all things. When we forgive, we're saying, I trust that God can heal this. I trust that even though, I mean, I hate to say it, I hate to imagine it, even though my children are dead, I know God has them in God's bosom, that they are fine, you know, they are well, that God can restore even this terrible, terrible loss. I can't even imagine that loss, but it's an act of faith to say that I forgive you and I trust God in this moment.
Right.
And it makes me wonder about, well, the shooter, anyone who does a terrible act like that, how does one forgive themselves? It doesn't even have to be such a dramatic and terrible act. It can be little things. I encounter many people who speak to me about things that they just can't forgive themselves for, and they wonder how do we struggle with that? How do we forgive ourselves? You know, or they sometimes it makes them feel worse when the other person has forgiven them. They just say they've already forgiven me, and they seem to be moving on, but I just can't get over it myself. I shouldn't have done whatever it was. Have you encountered that?
I have encountered it, even on a personal level, and I can tell you that prayer.
Mm.
Prayer. You know, I like to talk about having stomping prayers, you know, when you're stomping all over the house and you're wrestling with God and saying, you know, I can't let this go.
Right.
Show me how. Show me the way, the light.
How can I ever repair this or be whole again or whatever it is? I mean, we are, I mean, it's a very common saying, we're our own worst critics, and that's definitely true with sin. We hold things against us that God has long since forgiven us for. And in that sense, it's an act of trust and faith, too, to say that God has forgiven me. I have to be at least as nice to myself as I am to others to begin with. That's something. It's much easier usually for us to forgive others, not always. But if I can forgive them, I should be at least as kind to myself. And we know that God has forgiven us. We know that God's grace is profound and deep and can cover all sins. I mean, that was the reason Christ came to earth, was to show us forgiveness and God's love for us. So forgiveness is something, well, it's something that we as Christians cannot ignore. I mean, that's something that I am always a little bit startled when I encounter someone who says, I just can't forgive that person. And I recognize and I even understand the impulse, but in the light of Christ's love and sacrifice, I guess I get a little impatient with that thinking sometimes. Not the people who are doing it. I understand where they're at, but forgiveness is something that we are called to do. It is in the very DNA of what it means to be a Christian. And yes, take your time. I mean, I'm not saying you have to forgive instantly. It can be a lifelong pursuit, but it is something we must pursue. I mean, sorry.
Hold it up to the light. Nope, you've got it. I am right there with you. Yep. It's central to who we are as Christians. It is the core. The core of who we are as Christians is forgiveness. And I can't stress enough, in this time, in this world, in this country, in this community, it needs to be the thing that we keep front and center every single day in our lives, because you don't see a lot of it happening. And we need to be, as Christians, we need to be the cheerleaders for the kind of forgiveness that would make a community or a country or a world whole.
Absolutely. It's the only way we can restore things that are broken, really. One of the things I often talk about with people, I just had this conversation this last week, was the fact that not everyone asks for forgiveness, but we need to offer it, right? We need to share it with others. We need to say we're offering you this opportunity to forgiveness. And oftentimes what that looks like, I describe it as leaving the door open. God always leaves the door open for us. Whether we're asking for forgiveness from God or not, God always leaves the door open so that we can seek it. We don't always choose to. It's like grace in that way. Grace is something that God offers us, whether we want God to or not. Mm-hmm. And the only thing we can do is choose to accept it. And God is always offering us that forgiveness too, and we need to choose to accept it. And that's how we should treat others, right? If we offer them forgiveness, all they can do is accept it and walk through that door to a rebuilding of the relationship. And you can't do more than that. It's not your responsibility to do more than that, but it is our task to offer it, to seek reconciliation. That's what God teaches us, and that's how God treats each and every one of us. And when we are hopefully at our best, that's what we're striving to do for others, is to keep that door open and say, let's see if reconciliation is possible. We talked about forgiving ourselves, and that's how I think about forgiving others. Do you have anything you want to offer or add to forgiving others?
Just that. Always remember, grace wins.
Yeah, grace wins. I like that. I suppose we should wrap it up here a little bit.
So.
Yeah,
is it
about that time? Do you want to talk? Well, I'll let you. I feel like I've been talking too much.
No, you do. No, I think we've got this. Good. I just want to go back to the fact that we just need to remember every single day that forgiveness is the core. Mm-hmm. It is the core of Jesus' message. It is the core of who we are as Christians. Mm-hmm. And we so desperately need to be there front and center for the world.
Yeah. It's been a joy to preach about the Lord's Prayer these last few weeks. I hope that you've gotten something out of it. I mean, the Lord's Prayer is something that's so close to all of us Christians. It's something that we learn and memorize as small children, if we were part of the church then, but very quickly, even if we weren't. But just remember that Well, like many things, it's simple to understand, right? We talked about the hallowedness of God's name. We're asking for God's kingdom to be here on earth. We seek daily bread, and then, of course, forgiveness, and save us from those times of trial, those moments where things are hard. Those concepts are simple, but they take our whole lives to master and to just make a part of ourselves in each of our daily walks. And that's what the Lord's Prayer is about. It's about, I don't want to say perfecting. I don't think perfection's a thing we should strive for, but it's about striving to trust God and to be like God as we move through the world. And that's what the Lord's Prayer, I think, is a guideline for that, yeah?
Yep. Amen.
Oh, amen. Thank you. Let's move now to our hymn of the day, which is appropriately, of course, hopefully you're not sick of it, the Lord's Prayer. Please sing with us. Together, let us pray through our litany of prayers and blessings.
We pray to you, O Lord.
We come now to the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, 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 holy.
Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness. Forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us, renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. And now for our blessing. Now, if you would, please sing with us our sending hymn, Go, My Children, with My Blessing. This is hymn 543 in the red hymnals, or it's in the bulletins if you care to sing along with us.
Sleeping, I am.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.